And welcome. This is Mary Ellen McGonigal with your Friday afternoon MEM Edge show. And this is the show where we bring you where the action is in the broader markets. And as usual of late, it's been quite an active week. So lots here that we are going to go ahead and cover. Let's take a look at the agenda for today. First up, as usual, we are going to take a look at the broader markets, see where we closed the week, so that all of this is with an eye toward helping prepare you not only for next week, but beyond. So we're going to be looking out forward and seeing what the markets may have in store for us. Also, surprising strength in biotechs this week. And so we'll just take a quick look at that chart, but then also stocks for your watch list in that biotech space. It's an awfully large area, over 550 stocks reside. But there are a couple of bright spots that I will bring to your attention. And hopefully we continue to see a firming up in that risk on area of the markets. Inflation is real. We'll get into some of the economic data that's pointing to it. And of course, very pronounced movement from the Federal Reserve in response to this high inflation. So we'll get into some of the areas that are the best as far as defending your portfolio in this higher inflation period. The Dow outperformed this week. Certainly it was down, but not as much as the NASDAQ, a little bit lower down, less than the S&P, but we're going to take a look at some of the bright spots there as well. So from here, let's take a look. This is some of the more impactful headline news this week, and up front here and center was the Federal Reserve's shift in monetary policy, their easy policy of purchasing bonds and putting liquidity into the markets has shifted. Powell came out. They realized that the inflation that they had been recognizing is not transitory. It's really quite high and is anticipated to stay at least in this first half of next year. So big changes ahead as far as the tapering of bond buying and also with inflation now being actually recognized. So big shift there. Of course, we did see the markets initially responding in a positive manner. I think just the uncertainty being removed. But since then, there's been a reassessment. We'll get into all of that. Also, wholesale prices. This came out on Monday in November. The PPI was up 9.6%, really solidifying that concept that inflation is here. Of course, wholesale prices in turn will eventually lead to higher pricing on the retail level. And then retail sales came out and they did soften in November. Big impact there on the consumer discretionary area. And again, all about inflation. Volatility index, we did see it close above 20. That's kind of the line in the sand, if you will. So above 20 implies further in the way of volatility, certainly not as high as it was a week and a half ago, but we don't like to see it up here above 20. And then next week, even though we do have that holiday shortened period, we will get a fair number of data as it relates to economic numbers, consumer confidence, durable goods orders, and then core inflation among the more impactful news that is due to be out next week. So from here, let's go ahead, take a look at the broader markets. This is a daily price chart of the S&P 500, and the S&P was down 2% last week. But what I wanted to point out to you here are a couple of factors. One is that the S&P has now pulled back again to this 50-day simple moving average. This is this red moving average. We can see this relative strength indicator, a momentum indicator, has shifted now, just dipping below that net neutral 50 into negative territory. And then the stochastics generally are faster moving, and they are remaining up here in this positives place. This is another momentum indicator. So very mixed period here, but we can see that the potential uptrend that seemed to be in on its way to take the markets to a new high has faltered. So we are dipping back here. Pretty big volume on the sell-off. So definitely rocky, to say the least, but let's go ahead and drill down further, because we want, as always, to get a better feel for what is happening behind the S&P 500. Where is, if there's any, relative outperformance or strength relative to weakness? So here are those 11 S&P 500 sectors. I've gone ahead and added an RSI, that's a relative strength indicator, sorted it descending. I'll go ahead and update that and take a look. So XLV up here in the forefront, it was up 2.5% for the week relative to negative elsewhere as far as the broader markets. And we can just take a quick look here at this chart. This is something that my MEM Edge report, we picked up on this downtrend reversal 2 weeks ago. And at that time, it was primarily being driven by a number of large pharma stocks. And this week we are seeing that broadening out that I mentioned. So we'll get a little bit into that. And then consumer staples up here, they did drop this week, but that was after a pretty extensive move for this particular industry group. So this pullback is welcome as far as allowing entry into some of those names that really have had some nice moves. This is all about combating inflation, these higher yielding staples, as well as utilities and REIT. So we can see up here, your four horsemen, if you will, are all defensive and generally fare well during periods of difficult times for the market. But there is another caveat this time, in the sense that they also offer high yields, at least the staples, utilities, and real estate. And that is going to be one of the areas of strength as inflation, if it continues to head higher. So of course, we also want to be aware of the weaker areas in the market. And I talked about retail sales being not weak in the face of inflation. So really, it's the entire market is focused on inflation. If you're looking at those top performers and those weakest areas, there's a lot going on in the middle ground as well, but your more outsider areas are being impacted. So we can see this is XLY, consumer discretionary, has now turned negative. It's broken down below this 50-day simple moving average, negative outside momentum indicators. So a number of these retailers really just getting hammered. And then other areas in there as well. Tesla down over 8% for the week. That's going to impact that area as well. So from here, let's go ahead and take a look further at the markets. Some of these ETFs, certainly that I follow, are going to be more growth oriented. That is my focus. So I do have software and semiconductors here, the ETF. Also, each of the broader market indices, small caps and transportation, treasury yields, and so on. So again, 2 month daily price chart, sorting it by this RSI. And here's that biotech area right up here, front and center, up almost 5% for the week. Now, to be fair, this is not a pretty chart. We're not out of the woods yet by any means. Really, it's more of a highlight in the sense that the RSI has turned negative. We've had these other head fakes, if you will, that have faltered. This area, this 50-day simple moving average, is upside resistance. You're going to want to see the IBB ETF for biotechs get up above that 155 level. Next area of resistance up here at 158. But we are, again, seeing some vibrancy. It is encouraging because biotech stocks are very risky. So a move into this area could be potentially the beginning stages of gapping, or really kind of maybe getting us into a stronger period with the broader markets. So volatility, I mentioned that it is up here above that 20. Again, we're not back to this when we spiked with that Omicron variant that was exposed, but we are again up here above 20. Ideally, we want to be below that in a period of more stability, or stable, if you will. So let's go ahead and move on, because semiconductor stocks really had been holding up quite well. And we can see this week a deterioration down 4.3%. So definitely frothiness here. A lot of it, I will go into quite a bit more detail in my report over the weekend as to what is driving this. And it's not all negative. There are bright spots in that semiconductor space. So let's move on from here. And as always, make sure you're not overweighted in these weaker areas. This is the Russell 2000 small cap index, down another 2%. And this is another area that is considered risky simply because of the smaller market caps. It will be more volatile, and we can see that it is currently struggling. Let's go ahead back to the weakest area. Something I've been covering here for quite some time is software. And this is an area that, from my work, can historically really put you in front of some big movers. I know with my work, I was advising, we did get out of our software names before it broke down. We could see the stalling action that was taking place. And then, of course, now this very deep decline. Also, the high volume was generally on the downside. So software still struggling. It's going to take some time to get these stocks up off the mat, if you will. This is also inflation related, as to their earnings, future earnings, being worth less due to the inflationary pressures. So going to go ahead back. I want to make sure I did not miss anything in the way of any of these groupings. And indeed, not much else to report. Energy was the weakest group last week, but it's not for lack of energy oil prices. They're hovering here around 75. This is the price of the per barrel Brent pricing. Certainly other dynamics at play as it relates to the energy sector. So from here, I just want to check the clock. You know, I'm going to take a very brief break. And when we get back, we'll go ahead and take a look at that Dow, some biotechs, and lots more. So stick around. Hi, this is Mary Ellen McGonigal, author of the MEM Edge Report. In my biweekly report, I highlight top growth stocks as they enter buy zones. And I educate subscribers on why that stock is attractive, both technically and fundamentally. In addition, you'll be alerted to when it's time to exit that stock based on negative technical action. And this biweekly report gives you confidence by providing fundamental insights into why an area of the market is strong and which companies within that strong area have the best growth profiles that'll help propel that stock higher. Subscribers to the MEM Edge Report are benefiting from my expertise in uncovering top performing growth stocks. Subscribe now to take advantage of my special trial offer. And we are back. A pretty full screen here, but what we are looking at is the Dow Jones Industrial Average 30. The 30 stocks that are comprised of this index. And I've gone ahead, and this is something you can do really quite easily on stockcharts.com. Populate, you can cover really any area of the markets. So in this case, I have each of those Dow components listed here, RSI, and then in descending order. Again, this is that 2-month daily price chart. And you can see how quickly this view, particularly if you are very tuned into charts, you can just get easily in front of where that strength versus weakness is. So I am going to take us through some of these names up here in the forefront and tell you what's going on with them and why they are outperforming, certainly relative to the weaker names down here on the bottom. So let's get started here. First up, we can take a look. This is the currently relatively the strongest stock among those Dow components, and it is Amgen. So let's take a look at Amgen. Among other characteristics, Amgen actually offers a very healthy yield. So what I also wanted to share with you is that the company was upgraded, and back here, December 6th, this gap up, this is all about a Goldman Sachs upgrade because of their product line, their pipeline. So you can see that that kind of push can be the initial reason that some of these really beaten down names will begin to rise. In fact, I've been paying attention to it on a regular basis. Today, there were 15 stocks that were analysts were revising their estimates higher on. So it is primarily these really down and out names. And certainly with the damage we've seen here recently, it's going to be worth paying attention to going forward. But let's take a look at Amgen's chart here. I talked about biotech stocks. Of course, Amgen is a large company in that space. So we can see that it did have this base breakout. This is a one-month base breakout that took place, nice volume characteristics. Now, as it relates to next steps here, we are going to want to see a break of Amgen back up above this blue 200-day simple moving average. That's going to be your next hurdle. We did have that occur yesterday, but it pulled back. Nice price action today, buyers on today's pullback. So again, a nice break up above 227, and I can easily see further upside with Amgen. So from here, let's take a look at UNH, United Health. Now, this particular company, of course, is a HMO insurance related, and they're really viewed as the golden standard, if you will, among this group. And we can see that it broke out of a nice base here at the beginning of the month and is in a nice confirmed uptrend. So a lot of it having to do with the company, again, Wall Street upgrades because of their technological finesse, and they're just overall superior. They're viewed as a superior company in that space. So from here, let's take a look at IBM. And this is another potential turnaround candidate. The company is making strides as it does attempt to turn around. And we can see it is also finding resistance at this 200-day. That's that blue line. But our outside momentum indicators are positive. So again, a nice break up above that could get the stock going even higher, even further. And from here, I did want to share with you some of these other names that are up here in the forefront and point out what may be driving them. Here we are with Verizon. So you can see, again, really down and out name. They did come out with news that they are partnering with Google to bring 5G mobile computing to the masses, if you will. Big news, big spike up. So we could be in the beginning stages of a nice reversal here because we're getting nice volume characteristics on this upside action. Again, same broken record, but up here, this is going to be your next area of resistance at this 54.5. But again, outside momentum indicator positive. We had that nice MACD bullish crossover action taking place there. And just want to see if there's a couple of other names that I can share with you. Really, when we look, this is something I'm going to, if I have time, get into further. But 2 weeks ago, I did a show and I highlighted the dividend aristocrat companies, companies that for at least 25 years have raised their dividend annually. And so we can, on that list, Procter & Gamble, Coca-Cola, and McDonald's are each on that list. This is that high yield concept as it relates to fighting or at least countering inflation. So each of these names up here in the forefront, there are certainly other dynamics besides their yield. But generally speaking, consumer staple stocks such as Procter & Gamble and Coca-Cola have had the ability to raise their prices and not have pushback. They provide products that, well, we certainly don't need Coca-Cola, but demand is strong enough to overcome any increase in prices. Cisco is another name that is really looking quite attractive, breaking out of a base. This is one area of technology that is shining brightly among an otherwise tough area. So Cisco, I did just add another name in this group that's looking even more attractive, but it is that networking area. And then down here, of course, we want to pay attention. I talked about retail sales being weak. We did see it hit a number of these retailers. Walmart down 3% just today. Nike continuing to decline, fall further, negative momentum indicators. And then also software, which we looked at earlier, that is struggling. This is CRM, Salesforce. These guys for years were a real bellwether name among software, but you can see this is that deterioration that we're seeing. So that's a quick look at the Dow. From here, let's go ahead. I'll share with you some of the names that I did mention among biotechs. And really, this is going to be more of a watch list exercise, if you will, because they you really want to see that industry group exhibit positive characteristics before getting into other specific individual names. We did talk about that head fake concept. So really early here, this is Fate Therapeutics, F-A-T-E, potentially reversing its downtrend. I'm going to pull up a longer term chart and show you why I would even bring this stock to your attention. And it is because it does have that ability to really outpace the broader markets. This is taking us from that bear market into the end of 2020. The company is very cutting edge as far as their products and innovations. So we'll keep this on our radar, see if it's able to get back into a more constructive period. Another name that we can look at in biotech, they're not all going to be down and out like that. This is Alan, sure how to pronounce this one. It's ALNY. It's another company that has been around for quite some time. They do a lot with RNA therapeutics. And again, another winner, a stock that historically has been able to outpace the markets. And ideally, those same dynamics that drove the stock higher earlier this year could be coming back into play. So this name we have broken back up above that 50-day simple moving average, giving the stock more potential as it relates to further upside. Your outside momentum indicators are positive. Another name that we can take a look at here in that biotech space is a little bit of a smaller company, but it's ITOS Therapeutics. And we can see it had this nice base breakout this week. Now, well, it is up quite a bit today, 9%. So looking for potentially some kind of a pullback, but it is having really high volume characteristics all week as it formed the right side of the base and then eventually led to a base breakout. So elsewhere in healthcare, we can take a look at some other names that could really be setting up here quite nicely. QDEL, this is a COVID testing company, and it is another base breakout. Take a look at the volume characteristics here. We can see RSI is positive. MACD had that nice crossover up here in positive territory. So looking quite attractive. Another stock here in the medical systems, medical products space, a little bit early, but this is ICUI Medical and fell in line. This area of the markets, these medical product stocks have really been having a tough go of it over the last month or two. Going into this week, only about 10% of these medical product stocks were above their 50-day. So ICUI in the beginning stages of potentially forming the right side of a base, momentum just poised here to turn, and actually has turned positive. And then we have that nice MACD crossover there. And just a couple more names here that we can just keep on our radar. This is MedPace, M-E-D-P. And we can see this is a gap up, very strong earnings. And I talked about the entire group coming under distribution, which is why when I see this sharper of a pullback, it's not going to be as concerning because it's in line with its peers. But as the week progressed and today, we got some really nice bullish action. It's broken back above this 21-day simple moving average, RSI, now up here in positive territory. And we can see the black line poised to turn up above that red signal line, another bullish signal. They do have seen their estimates being revised higher. Earnings, 24% this year, 15% next year. So nice growth prospects. And then one last name, and I'll just move on from here, but that you can keep on your radar. We are super early in the possibility for this, but this is ARK Genomics, ARKG. And this is another one that I, at the end of last year into the beginning of this year, had this on the suggested holdings list. It was a nice big winner for us, but boy, has it fallen out of bed. It did get up here as high as 115 and then got down to 58. So a lot in the way of repair needed here. But again, that concept that it can, once it gets going, can really march to new highs. So from here, I am going to go ahead and share a little bit more as it relates to those inflation counter types of stocks and take a look at some of these higher yielders that are kind of interesting. They're some of them more than others. But first up, let's take a look at Altria Group MO. And this is another one of those potential downtrend reversals. Nice big volume as it breaks back above this 200-day simple moving average. This particular company does offer a 7.4% yield. So that's quite healthy. We can see it's getting into this overbought position after this extensive move over the last 2 weeks. So it may need to rest or settle. Consolidate would be a better word. But again, that nice high yield driving. Let's see. Well, I wrote the company down and not the ticker symbol. So let's see if I can go ahead and pull up this particular company because it is food related. And they do quite a bit in the way of sauces, jellies, and so forth. And they also offer a 6.1% yield. So we can see this pullback here is reversing. We've broken back above these shorter-term moving averages. Your RSI is now up here in positive territory. MACD having that black line up through the red crossover. So very, very interesting name there. I'm going to share with you a theme among REIT stocks. This is something I've written about as to why REIT stocks are a good hedge against inflation, not only because of their high yield, but they do have inflation clauses, many of them built into their structure with their tenants. So first up, this is Public Storage. PSA is the ticker symbol, a nice 2.2% yielder. We can see where it broke out here into a nice confirmed uptrend. And so we want to look at historical precedents, and we can see, yes, it's overbought, but it has had the ability to retain an overbought position and continue to trade higher. However, of concern to me is the MACD up here at the upper reaches of its range. So we don't have to go back too far. We can see here in April after an overbought position. So ideally with PSA, a nice period of consolidation, and then it's entering this stock on its potential next leg up. But really I'm sharing with you as well the concept that this storage space, that is the area of Public Storage, of course. This is Cube Smart, not as electrifying, but a nice 3.1% yield. Estimates are being revised higher. So this is a REIT stock that also offers storage options. We can look at NSA, 2.4% yielder, just really nicely in an uptrend. We had that nice momentum shift here, negative into positive with an outside bullish RSI as well, 2.4, I believe I may have mentioned that. And then one last name in this storage space, because it really was a theme when looking, and this one has been in an uptrend, Extra Space Storage, 2.3%, nice uptrend, nice outside momentum indicators, looking quite constructive. So from here, we can take a look at another area. In fact, I believe I am running out of time, so I will save that for next time. Those of you that haven't already, take a look at my MEM Edge report. I have a four-week trial offer that you can take advantage of. I actually sent out four reports last week each day just because of the rockiness. Alerts were included in that, and then individual stock suggestions or deletions. So yeah, use that link below and hit that like button. Everyone have a great weekend, and I will see you next week.
Hey, Grayson Rose here with Stock Charts. Thank you so much for watching. I hope you enjoyed that video. If you did, consider giving it a like down below, maybe leave us a comment, and if you're new to the channel, you can subscribe at the link up above. We're gonna bring you daily content from an incredible collection of technical analysts and financial experts.